Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah reward you all for attending today, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our gathering. May you all benefit, inshallah, and make this a reason. May Allah make this a reason for us to improve in our religion. Alhamdulillah, my brothers and my sisters, I'm sure you're all aware that we live in a very, very rough time. A time of corruption, a time of fasad. It takes any Muslim now, maybe 5 minutes on a news station, to realize the state the Muslim Ummah has reached. Maybe the worst state in centuries, maybe the worst state since Rasulullah's time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Corruption, fasad, oppression. Muslim blood is the cheapest blood. And many, many countries, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, Egypt, numerous countries Islam is suffering in. And now, my brothers and my sisters, every Muslim has to look deep and ask himself genuinely, what am I going to do about this? Do I really care about the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do I really care about Islam? If I ask any of you here tonight, if I ask anyone, if you talk to your friends and ask them, do you care about Islam? Do you really care about this deen? Do you care about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do you care about the Sunnah? Everyone says, Allahu Akbar. Of course I care. Of course I love this deen. Of course I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course I love Islam. Some people will go to the extent of saying, I'm happy to give my life for deen. But the truth is, my brothers and my sisters, that unfortunately, we are very, 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 very easy when it comes to claims. When it comes to talks and claims, very, very easy. We say talk is cheap, very, very cheap. Who is really, really concerned about this ummah? Who of us, my brothers and my sisters, is genuinely worried and upset and disturbed about what's happening in the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our time? You watch the news in Syria, you watch the news anywhere in the world, and maybe when you watch the news, you see a little baby who has lost his mother or a father who has lost his child, and maybe you will shed a tear or two. Maybe you'll get affected. But 5 minutes later, you and your family are having a barbecue or eating McDonald's somewhere. Very, very, very easy for us to forget the hardship this ummah is facing, the problems our religion is facing. Very, very easy to make a claim, very hard to act. We have even lost our dreams. If you ask a Muslim now, male or female, brother, sister, what is your dream? What's your aspiration? What are you working towards? The majority of people, their dreams are worldly based. They dunya based now. Say, I wish I can become rich. I wish I can have a house on the beach. I wish I can own this car. I wish I can marry this person. I wish I can be a celebrity like this person, like this actor or this actress. This is what common amongst us in every Muslim society, in everywhere we've went, subhanAllah. We've seen this tendency that our youth, they are aspiring dunya. And when it comes to akhirah, when it comes to the hereafter, when it comes to the pleasure of Allah, our aspirations are minimal. We find people saying, Wallah, all I want is just to slip into Jannah. I just want to enter Jannah. One foot, I'm happy. SubhanAllah, in dunya, in worldly things, you are not content of being of the lower rank. You aren't content with having something simple, you know, in dunya and live a simple life. You wanted the best status. You wanted the best car. You wanted the best house. Now comes the hereafter, the true life, your real life. And now you want to slip into Jannah? Because our dreams are wrong. Our dreams are not faith-based. They're not iman-based. We have lost that connection. We have lost the battle within. Khalas, we think Islam will never stand up, you know. Nowadays we hear people, Muslims love talking about the signs of the hour. Ever felt this in your community, you know? People love hearing about the Dajjal. They love hearing about the Mahdi. Why? You know, the state of Islam will, you know, this current state will end. We just want it to end. Anyhow, anyway, you know. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. You know, we've reached such a weak state. We talk about the Mahdi now as if, khalas, from now until the Mahdi appears, There is no hope, my brother, my sister. Let's just continue making more dunya. Let's just continue being engaged in this world and its desires and lust and shahawat. And don't worry about the hereafter. We'll wait for the Mahdi, inshallah. Don't worry about deen. We'll wait for the Mahdi, inshallah. Well, guess what? This was not the way of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This wasn't the way of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This wasn't the way of his companions. Islam does not know negativity. Islam does not know giving up. إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ Only those who do not have iman, they lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's victory. We have to dream on. We have to actually aspire. We have to be ambitious. We have to dream. We have to think properly. Where do I want my rank to be with Allah? Am I content with something small? This shouldn't be the case. Look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and how they viewed things. A famous story, a man radiallahu anhu, his name, maybe many of you don't know him. You know, his name is Rabi'a ibn Ka'b al-Aslami radiallahu anhu. This young companion was from Ahlul Suffa. Those of you who know, Ahlul Suffa were those poor people in Medina. They were homeless, no home, no wife, sometimes even no clothes. They did not have enough clothes to cover their own awrah. Their own private parts. Sometimes they had to pray half naked or part of his awrah showing. No food, nothing. One of them was Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, very famous. But this man, Rabi'a ibn Ka'b, was from Ahlul Suffa. وَكَانَ يَخْدِمُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ He was one of the servants of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So one day, he is preparing the wudu for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, preparing water for his ablution. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, looks at him. He is pleased with him. He is pleased with his service. So he says to him, Ya Rabi'a, O Rabi'a, salni, ask anything of me. Now I want you please to live this story. You know, get involved in the story. Imagine yourself in Rabi'a's shoes. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the king of Medina. I have no home. I have no job. I have no wife. I have no clothes. And the king of Medina, now the leader of Medina, is asking me, ask something of me. I'll do whatever you ask of me. What would you do? What would you ask for? Wouldn't you ask for a house? If the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to the Ansar, people of Medina, if he says to them, give him a house, wallahi, instantly they will give him a house. Marry him off, find him a wife. Instant, the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, done and thus finished. Whatever he says happens. Give him a house, give him a wife. I can ask anything now. Or give me clothes, Ya Rasulullah. Give me a abaya. Give me something to wear to cover my awra. Rabi'a radiallahu anhu, look at the focus. Look at the fikr. Look at the direction. Rabi'a radiallahu anhu says, Ya Rasulullah, as'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah. O Prophet of Allah, I want to be with you in Jannah. Not any Jannah, Ya Rasulullah. Not any Jannah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He didn't ask him for any Jannah. He wants to be in the Prophet's rank. I want to be with you in Jannah, Ya Rasulullah. In your rank in Jannah. What an aim. What an ambition from someone who has nothing in this world. قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَسْأَلُكَ مُرَافَقَتَكَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ So it's like he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, sometimes I feel when I read this hadith, that the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asking him, when he was requesting him to put forward something, he actually expected him to ask something of dunya, some food, a clothes, something. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, أَوَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ أَوَ هَبَ or a good, mashallah, anything else? Now say you want a wife. Now say you want a house. Find me a job, Ya Rasulullah. Give me some money, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهُ وَذَاكَ That's all I want. All I want is to be with you in Jannah. But the path is not easy. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows that. If you want to be with me in Jannah, قَالَ فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ If you want to be with me in Jannah, Ya Rabi'a, then please assist me by doing a lot of prostrations, a lot of sujood. You need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on your side. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to allow you that rank. You have to work hard for it. But look at the direction, look at the focus, and compare the fikr of Rabi'a radiallahu anhu to our dreams and our ambitions. Where do we want to be? What do we want to do? No ambition, No ambition in our ummah now to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to get the highest ranks. Even though, wallahi, it's very easy in our time compared to previous times. There's no competition. Everyone's chasing dunya anyway. Everyone's after dunya anyway. Anyone who does something small for deen, straight away he becomes Allah. Straight away Allah uses him. Because there's not much people taking that path in the first place. But subhanAllah, still the majority of our ummah are directing their fikr and attention and effort and focus and sacrifice and investing it in this world. And the fikr and the concern and the worry for the hereafter is minimal. You see all this corruption around you. You see all this fasad around you. All this haram, orders of Allah are being disobeyed left, right and center. No salah, no deen, falling in sin, falling in major sin, abundant in every community. What do you feel in your heart? How can we go and sleep properly? You know, we miss Fajr. Sometimes if you sleep, you don't put your alarm on, you will sleep such a good night's sleep. You will miss Fajr next day. That's how much there's no concern in your heart. That's how void your heart is of concern. If you have court tomorrow morning, if you have an exam in your university tomorrow morning, you find yourself, you know, you can't sleep at night or you keep waking every hour. Because you're hyped up, there's anxiety, you're anxious. But when it comes to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one is really worried. This has to change. This has to change. We need to be inspired to be able to understand, to know that it's my job. It's no one else's job. You know, every one of us has succumbed to the fact, khalas, Islam is weak. You know, what am I going to do, man? Too much corruption. You know, enter any Muslim house. Enter any Muslim house, speak with your friends. Test this, what I'm telling you now, out. Go to any Muslim and say, brother, are you content with the conditions of Islam? Allahu Akbar. We have become experts in highlighting the problems the ummah is facing. Ah, brother, wallahi, you know, the rulers are doing this and the ulama are corrupt and this is happening and people owe money and people don't have manners and people don't have akhlaq and people do this and don't. Complain, he will talk to you for 2 hours about the problems the ummah is facing. MashaAllah, beautiful, MashaAllah, khair. So what are you doing about it? Nothing. If my wife is safe, my home is safe, I have regular income coming, my job is safe, alhamdulillah, I'm happy. What's happening in the ummah is none of my business. I keep pointing out mistakes only. Oh, you know what? The ulama should do this. The rulers should do that. And the business people should do this. People who have money should do this. You know, event organizers should do this. And I'm sitting on my bum doing nothing. Very, very easy to criticize. No action in our life. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every century sends someone to revive this ummah's deen, to bring deen back. Don't we aspire to be this person? Don't you hope that Allah uses you? Imagine the rank, imagine the honor of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I was the reason. I was the chosen one. Allah chose me. Or I was part of the group. In most of the ulama, when they explained this hadith, they said it doesn't necessarily mean it has to be one person. It can be a group of people. Allah chose them for a certain era, a certain time to revive the ummah's deen. Do I aspire to be one of those people? Or am I going to stay deadhead all my life? I'm not going to move. I won't do anything about it. People with true iman, with true understanding, with true worry and concern for the ummah, do not know the meaning of giving up. They don't know the meaning of negativity. They are there, they understand, I will do everything I can. I will do everything I can to reach this rank for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to choose me. Look at the Prophet's life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One man, my brothers and my sisters, one man. Look at what one man did to humanity. Look at what one man did to the world. You say corruption in the ummah. Now you see the ummah is in a very bad state. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our role model, was given the mission of da'wah, there was approximately 360 idols around the Kaaba. The symbol of tawheed and monotheism, the symbol of iman, the symbol of the deen of Islam, is surrounded by 360 idols, worshipped other than Allah. You want more corruption than that?
But still the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not give up. He had this concern and worry in his heart, like a nuclear, you know, a nuclear engine inside him. Concern and worry, how can humanity see the light? How can humanity come to this deed and understand? Subhanallah, the energy, the perseverance, 360 idols did not make him lose hope, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He started this work of da'wah. And this work of haqq, my brothers, this work of da'wah is so powerful. Don't belittle da'wah, my brothers and my sisters. You know, people say there's too much corruption, there's too much darkness. You know what the ulama and scholars say? Say there's nothing called darkness. There's actually nothing called darkness. Darkness is the absence of light. See, if all this room, if all this hall now was completely dark, all what you need to do is light a match. Once you light a match or a torch, Allahu Akbar, light comes straight away. You know, this is the quality of batil, the quality of corruption and darkness, is that they run away very easy. إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا قُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ. As soon as righteousness comes, as soon as the truth appears in anyone, batil fades straight away. Corruption and darkness fade straight away. But where is this truth? Where is this haqq? Every one of us is waiting for the person next to him to start. Inshallah, I'm waiting for this brother. He's doing a great job, mashallah. Inshallah, this deen will come, inshallah, from this country. Brother, it doesn't matter where deen comes from. Allah will ask you. Allah will ask you what you did for deen. What did you do for Islam? Where is your effort? Where is your share? Where is your part? You know, where is your perseverance and sabr on the da'wah? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 10 years, my brothers and my sisters, 10 years, 10 long years, he gives da'wah in Quraysh. Please try to understand the depth of this story. 10 years, I'm being persecuted. My daughters got divorced. I get abused, accused. Subhanallah, the Sadiq al-Amin, the trustworthy, the honest, became the soothsayer, the magician, you know, the kathib, the liar. Every name in the world they called him. Abuse, accusation, by war on every level. 10 years of persecution and torture. Anyone accepts Islam straight away, if they can, they will harm him and abuse him. After 10 years, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam feels that maybe if Quraysh will not accept Islam, maybe I should try people in al-Ta'if. Aisha radiallahu anha once asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, O Prophet of Allah, was there a day that you ever faced that was harder than the day of Uhud? You know, in the battle of Uhud, 70 companions were martyred in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amongst them, Hamza radiallahu anhu, Amm al-Nabiyy sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His uncle Hamza was martyred, you know. He was harmed sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His forehead was injured. His tooth was broken sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Any day that was hard, he goes to her, yes, there's a harder day. Which day, Ya Rasulullah? He goes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the day when I went to At-Ta'if. Imagine approximately 80 kilometer distance. In some narrations, he walked, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on his feet. He walked to At-Ta'if 80 kilometers to call them to Islam, to call them to Allah. And who am I? Who is the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Habibullah, the beloved of Allah. The best man to ever step foot on this earth. And Allah's watching and Allah can see. He goes to At-Ta'if, calls them to Islam. The leaders of At-Ta'if abuse him and make fun of him. Say, Allah didn't find anyone better than you to send? You? Subhanallah, they abuse him. Not only this, as he is leaving, you know, with a feeling of loss. Imagine you just walked 80 kilometers and now you have to return back to Mecca and the only hope is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't know what to do anymore. 10 years he is waiting sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling them for their own benefit. And then they order the little kids in town, the crazy people in town, to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and stone him. He was stoned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They threw rocks at him until his honorable feet started bleeding, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine, mental pain, physical pain, and Allahu A'lam how many kilometers they followed him, making fun of him, swearing at him, and pelting him with rocks. What would you feel? What would you do? Nowadays, if I give da'wah to a person, and he treats me, you know, he responds in a negative way, I start cursing him straight away, like, inshallah, you go to Jahannam, Ya Rab. I have no patience. You know, I say, brother, please come to masjid. No, what am I? Ya Allah, ruh. Don't, please don't come. You know, 10 years, he is patient, subhanAllah. And then after all of this, they do this to him. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is returning now to Quraysh, returning now to Mecca, in such a feeling, such a down point in his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah sends Jibreel, with him the angel of mountains, Malakul Jibal. Jibreel gives salam to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is Jibreel? Allahu Akbar, Qawiyun Amin, might and strength, the leader of angels. If he, alayhi salam, when Allah ordered him to destroy the people of Lut with the tip of a feather of one of his wings, he grabbed the people of Lut, the whole villages, up to As-Sama' al-Dunya and flipped them upside down and followed them with rocks. Jibreel came, alayhi salam, gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam salam, qala ya Muhammad, inna Allah qad sami'a qawla qawmika lak. Allah has heard what your people have said to you. Allah is watching everything. And now he has sent with me the angel of mountains, Malak al-Jibal. So the angel of Jibal, the Malak of Jibal, the angel of mountains said, ya Rasulullah, Allah has heard what people said to you. And if you order me now, in shi'ta atbaqtu alayhim al-akhshabayn. Al-akhshabayn were the two mountains surrounding Mecca, not Ta'if, so you're confused. The two mountains surrounding Mecca. Now, Quraysh, that's arrogant with you for 10 years. If you want now, the Nusra of Allah is ready. I will destroy Quraysh instantly for you. What would you do? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. Don't destroy them. I ask Allah, بل أسأل الله أن يخرج من أصلابهم من يعبد الله لا يشرك به شيئا. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that maybe if not them, maybe their children will accept Tawheed and Islam. Look at the perseverance and patience in da'wah. He could have easily finished them off, but he has perseverance in his dream. He wants guidance. He wants humanity to come to deen. He's not bloodthirsty like he is, you know, portrayed now in our time. He wanted people to come to Islam. He wanted people to be saved. This was the quality of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Perseverance in his dream, in his da'wah. Look at Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu. Maybe you say, but he's a prophet of a different rank. How about Mus'ab? One man. What can one man do, my brothers and my sisters? How can one man serve deen? Mus'ab radiallahu anhu, you know, young boy, mudallal, spoilt. Before Islam, he was living in luxury. The best of clothes, the best of perfume. His mom was filthy rich. Whatever he wanted, you know. أعطر فتى في قريش. The best perfume in all of Quraysh. If he passed through a road, you know, maybe hours after he passed, people say, Mus'a passed by here. I can smell his fragrance. So spoiled, so much luxury in this dunya. But then the love of Allah and his Prophet entered his heart. Iman entered his heart. And when Iman entered his heart, straight away ambition came for the hereafter rather than this dunya that is, you know, that's not going to last. His ambition was converted to the hereafter. How can I reach ranks with Allah? This man, my brothers, waited for his opportunity. Patiently. Now deprived of all his money. Now deprived of all his luxury. When 12 of the Ansar gave bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we call them al-nuqaba. When these nuqaba of Ansar, people of Medina, when they met Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Hajj season, yearning, thirsty for deen, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to this young boy, this young man, and said, ya Mus'ab, you go with them to Medina, the land of hijrah, the land of migration. He sends one man. What's one man gonna do with the whole tribe? What's man gonna do in a strange land? So Mus'ab radiallahu anhu, one man, my brothers and my sisters, goes to Medina with these 12 new converts to Islam. One of them is As'ad ibn Zurara radiallahu anhu. So As'ad is like his, you know, he's like his guide. What do we do? Where do we start? Imagine you arrive in a town, a city, everyone's non-Muslim. What do you do? Where do you start from? Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu chose a position. They sat down in this position and then straight away started calling to Allah. Started the effort of da'wah, the work of da'wah. So the leaders of Ansar heard of the arrival of Mus'ab, a man from Quraysh who was calling to a different religion. One of these main tribes of Aus, you know, the tribe of Aus had sub-tribes. One of these main leaders of Aus was Banu Abd al-Ashhal. Amongst them, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Usayd ibn Hudayr, radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. At the time, non-Muslims and leaders of these of Medina, leaders of Ansar, they hear that a man came. So straight away, you know, what are we going to do? Sa'd and Usayd, they start discussing, what should we do? So Sa'd says, you go and see what this man is doing. So he grabs his spear, Usayd ibn Hudayr, and goes to kill Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu. He arrives where they're calling to Allah, and he starts threatening them. I will do this and I will do that. Why did you come here? What are you doing? With da'wah, there always has to be trials and tests. Always. So he, radiyallahu anhu, started, you know, threatening them. So Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu said, why don't you sit down and listen to what I have to say? If you like what I have to say, beautiful. If you don't like what I have to say, I will leave instantly. So Usayd said, good, all right. He stuck his spear on the floor and then he sat down to hear. In a few minutes, Usayd radiyallahu anhu accepted Islam instantly. Look at the influence of Mus'ab. Look at the influence and effect of sacrifice. He started talking. Sometimes we think da'wah is words. Da'wah is not words, my brothers and my sisters. Da'wah has to be backed up. Has to be backed up with sacrifice and dua and connection with Allah. So Mus'ab, a few words, radiyallahu anhu, Usayd converted straight away. Now Usayd said, behind me is a man, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. If this man accepts Islam, all my tribe will convert to Islam. So Usayd goes back to Sa'd and says, I didn't succeed, please come and deal with the matter. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, radiyallahu anhu, comes at the time, also non-Muslim, of course, and does the same thing. Mus'ab says the same thing to him. Sit down, relax, see what I have to say. He calls him to Islam, and before you know it, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu also converts. Then Sa'd and Usayd, they both go back to the people. They gather all the tribe, and he says, by Allah, I have converted to Islam. I will boycott you all if you do not accept the deen of Allah. So in moments, the whole tribe of Banu Abd al-Ashhal accepts Islam. All in the books of Mus'ab. In 1 year, 12 months, Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu was working in da'wah. Complete sub-tribes of the Ansar accepted Islam, and not one house in Medina, not one house did not have a convert in it. Not one house. Every single house Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu reached. Imagine meeting Allah on Judgment Day and Medina is in your pocket. All Medina, with the work in it, with the da'wah that came from it, with the light that spread to the world from it. You go and pray in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is there. And Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu is accumulating all these rewards. Why radiyallahu anhu, a true man. When the battle of Uhud came, Mus'ab radiyallahu anhu was martyred. So he died shortly, year 3 Hijri. Yani he migrated to Medina, you know, and a few years passed away, radiyallahu anhu. This champion, this hero that gave his life for deen, when they came to bury him, they did not have a big enough shroud to cover his body. If you cover his head, his feet appear. You cover his feet, his head appears. They asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do we do, ya Rasulullah? He goes, cover his head and put some plants on his feet. This is the state he died in. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Quran to be read until Judgment Day. مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. Amongst the believers that are true men, not all believers and men. When we say men here, we don't mean male. It can be a male, anyone can be a male. But to be a man, whether male or female, have the qualities of men, of true men, that fulfilled the promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ. Some of them were martyred. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ. Our others are dying and yearning for the opportunity to give their lives for the sake of Allah. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ. وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. They didn't play around with their religion and change the deal they made with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where do we stand now? Where do I stand? What have I done for my deen? What have I done for Islam other than complaining and putting others down, criticizing people? Oh, I'm weak, I can't do anything. How can we change this? Wallahi, you can. Wallahi, we can, my brothers and my sisters. You have no idea. Wallahi, a little effort in our time, with genuine dedication and sincerity, a pure intention, you have no idea how much this damages the fortress of batil and corruption. You have no idea. A word you say sometimes can change someone's life. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من دعا إلى هدى. Anyone who calls to guidance, كان له من الأجر مثل أجور من تبعه لا ينقص ذلك من أجورهم شيئا. Anyone who calls to guidance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the reward of everyone who follows him, without this decreasing the reward in any sense. So people who are calling to Allah and working and serving this deen, they are the champion investors. They will come on judgment day, and after the death by ease, the books are still opened, accumulating reward. Some people, wallahi, in our time, because of them, countries came back to deen. Countries woke up. Schools and madaris and huffaz of Quran and ulama graduated because of the efforts of certain people. But we are dead inside. We have lost this energy, this hope, this dream. This is why this has to change, my brothers and my sisters. Don't look at yourself. We are weak people. Look at the power of Allah. If Allah chooses you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the game. The game is making Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose you and select you. If you do the right thing and you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the right intention, wallahi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use you for his deen. And if he uses you, Allahu Akbar, his nusra will come, his help will come. Don't look at the batil and the corruption. All of this will fade away once the light appears, once the haq appears. But the problem that we are facing is that no one wants to start with himself. I want others to change first. How many times have you heard in your life people complaining about the bad manners of Muslims? You know, you enter a gathering, Muslims have the worst manners. Muslims are this, Muslims are that. This should change, mashallah. You wanted to change? Yes, wallahi. Do you really want it to change? Wallahi, I want it to change. Then start with yourself. You, don't look at anyone else. If deen starts by action, not by words. You know, it starts by action. If I act, then when I speak, my words will become effective. But if I continuously talk about good manners, and then on the first corner, people see me having bad manners, all what you say will go in vain. This is why it is very important not to, you know, to understand how to start. I need to change myself. I need to aspire and have this hope and dream to be, maybe Allah will select me. Maybe Allah will use me. What an honor. Wallahi, what an honor to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you've done something for deen. Imagine this, my brothers and my sisters. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ما منكم من أحد إلا وسيكلمه ربه ليس بينه وبينه ترجمان. Every single one of us will stand before Allah on Judgment Day. You and Allah, no intermediary, no one in between, you no translator, nothing. You and Allah, the King of Kings, سبحانه وتعالى. فينظر أيمن منه. You will look to your right. فلا يرى إلا ما قدم. You will only see your actions. وينظر أشأم منه. You look to your left. فلا يرى إلا ما قدم. Only your actions. ثم ينظر أمامه فلا يرى إلا النار تلقاء وجهه. He will look in front of him. He will see hellfire waiting to grab him. فلا يرى إلا النار تلقاء وجهه. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم فاتقوا النار ولو بشق تمرة. Save yourselves from hellfire even by half a date in charity. Imagine standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on judgment day, barefooted, naked, uncircumcised, exactly like your mom gave birth to you. And then Allah is saying to you now, my slave, show me what you have done for my deen. How did you serve Islam? How did you thank the blessings I gave you? Don't you want to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, you have your box of good deeds and bad deeds with you. You want to show Allah the best you've done. You want to show Allah this action that, you know, inshallah will guarantee you going to Jannah, the highest ranks. Have you ever thought of this box? What do you have with you? You're 30 years old, you're 25, you're 20, you're 15, you're 40, you're 50, whatever age you are. Have you ever thought of this box? What have I done? What can I stand up and say, Ya Allah, I've done this for deen? Sahaba radiallahu anhum will stand up proudly. They will look in the box and they will have numerous achievements to show Allah how much they sacrificed for Islam. How much because of their efforts, because of their sacrifices, because of their dreams. Me and you are in today in Malaysia, you know, thousands of kilometers away from Mecca and Medina, saying La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Imagine if Sahaba radiallahu anhum were negative like us. Oh, what can we do? The Prophet passed away. What am I going to do? How am I going to make Islam spread? You know what? I'm just going to look after my family and my kids. Imagine if the Sahaba were like us, Islam would have never spread. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Prophet such a teacher, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He left true men behind him that carried the responsibility and passed on the amana and the message to everyone in the world. Now this amana, this responsibility came to me and you. The responsibility of Islam, wallahi, Allah will ask us. Wallahi, my brothers, when are we going to understand that Allah will ask you individually, what have you done for my deen? What have you done for Islam? You saw the haram, you saw the corruption. What did you do? Ya Allah, sorry, Allah, I was busy with work. Do you think these excuses will benefit you on judgment day? Ya Allah, sorry, I was busy with my wife or my children. Wallahi, they will not benefit you. If you think these excuses will work on judgment day, read Islam again, learn Islam again. Wallahi, they will not work. Because deenuka deenuka lahmuka damuk, this deen should be of flesh and blood. Sahaba radiallahu anhum sacrificed everything for this deen to spread. Now we don't even sacrifice a bit of time, a bit of money for the sake of deen. For dunya, mashallah, we spend on holidays and this and that. But comes the deen of Allah, all of a sudden we all turn into poor people that don't have money to spend for the deen. All of a sudden we don't have time and are very, very busy. All these excuses will collapse. And you're standing before Allah, and now you have to show Allah what you have done. This is why, my brothers and my sisters, please, enough negativity. Don't look at your ability, look at Allah's qudra. Wallahi, Allah can select you and choose you. Dream. Have a dream. Sit down with yourself and dream. Aspire. Aspire to become someone special in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sit down. Analyze. Look at your talents and abilities. Where can I serve? Where can I help? Sometimes, wallahi, a small effort you do can have a big effect on the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aspire to be special. You know, people say, but I don't know much. Learn. You know, I'm not an alim, I'm not a scholar, I'm not a da'i. Wallahi, you have no idea, my brothers and my sisters. Nowadays, it's very, very easy. Very, very easy to serve the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So please, be ambitious. You know, have hopes and dreams. Dream for the deen of Allah. Dream to be special in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't succumb to shaitan and his, you know, he's trying to put you down. Nothing will happen. Have perseverance, have patience, ask Allah, beg of Allah to use you, and wallahi you will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never let you down. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who practice what he nas'al Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yaj'alana min alladhina yastami'una al-qawla fayattabi'una ahsana. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Jazakum Allah khair wa barakallahu fikum.